endophytes or plant biotechnology, you can say. Plant endophytes, isolation of plant endophytes, their identification, as well as synthesizing nanoparticles, the nano delivery with the help of those plant endophytes. That is also one of the area. Then herbal nano delivery system. We have seen most of the nano delivery formulations like phospholipid complexes will be there. Then liposomes, solid lipid nanoparticle, or the microsponge nano sponges. Yes, I'm also exploring the same area, but by using the herbal drugs. Initially, when I started working at in that area with taking plant extract as well as the crude drugs, because of the facilities and all the things, or the specific quantification by using sophisticated instruments like HPLC and all the things, we were facing the major problems. So then we shifted to the pure moieties like quercetin, rutin, then bicalin, then right now we are working on the hesperitin, like that. So that is also one of the area. Right now I'm working in collaboration with almost 10 to 12 institutions, out of which Dr. Ritesh Bole sir is one of the person with whom I'm working right now. Then institution or the universities from Bharatidasan University, Tanjavur is there, Nagpur University, then Mohanlal Sugai University, Rajasthan is there, as well as some abroad, like that is Cambridge University is there. Then at Poland, some molecular life sciences department is there. Yes, we are exploring whatever the all the possible ways we can. And I think being academician, we need to go in that way only. 6 months back, when Bhujbal sir called me, that is they are planning for one of the faculty development program, and that is Atal FDP. And sir, will you be there as one of the resource person, or will you share your views or your research on the same platform? Then I agreed for that, and I gave the topic, that is a polyherbal Grita. Yes, sir. In even last 1.5 years, my two PhD students, they worked on Ayurvedic formulation, specifically Grita formulations. One student, he's from Pune University only, that is Mr. Sandesh Wayan from JSPM's College of Pharmacy, Charak College of Pharmacy. Yes, Viva is scheduled in next week only, PhD Viva, and he has worked on a polyherbal Grita formulation. Now, if you see most of the pharma faculties, they must have heard about the Grita. Grita, which is nothing but a cow ghee based herbal formulations. So what's novel in that? Of course, I won't say it is novel in that, because in Ayurveda, Grita is already mentioned. Pharmaceutics people specifically, they are working on the lipid based preparation, the lipid carrier systems. I will say in Ayurveda, this is one of the oldest lipid based carrier system, which is nothing but a cow ghee based Grita. In my today's this sharing experience in this on this platform, I will be sharing not only the development or the preparation of the Grita formulation, but along with that, in Ayurveda, certain processes, some processes, or in other terms, in Ayurvedic terms, it is called as a samskara. Samskara processes are there which can be done on a Grita formulations to enhance its stability as well as the therapeutic efficacy. That is my major concern regarding with this topic. Okay, so let's start with that is a polyherbal Grita, an integrative approach. The outline that will be, I will be briefing about the Ayurveda first, then Indian cow and Panchagavya formulations. Out of this, those Panchagavya, one of the gavya, that is a cow ghee, and a Grita formulation based on the same polyherbal Grita. Then, as I mentioned, that is a Murchana Samskara, as well as the Shatadhuta process, and the therapeutic evolution. If I'm not wrong, my slides are changing. Am I right?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. Thank you. So let's start with that is a Ayurveda. If you know, if you see, just a minute. Still, my slides are visible, no, sir?
Yes, yes, it is visible.
Okay, okay, okay.
But put it on a presentation board.
Yes, just a minute, just a minute. Is it okay now?
Yeah, yes, yes.
Okay. Ayurveda, which is supposed to be a mother of all healings, as we know, it is oldest system of medicine. Oldest system of medicine. In fact, etymologically, if we see Ayurveda, it is a combination of two Sanskrit words. One is Ayur, that is life, and Veda, that is knowledge or science, or the science of life. Yes, science of life. If you see the Ayurveda treatises, the different texts, the main three texts are there. That is the Charak Samhita, Shushrut Samhita, and Ashtanga Hridaya. Now, in case of a Charak Samhita, that is specifically the medicines which are used, that has been focused. Whereas in Shushrut Samhita, the surgery or the techniques, those are mentioned. Whereas in case of Ashtanga Hridaya, it is a combination of a Charak Samhita and Shushrut Samhita. Other than these three main texts of the treatise, some other minor information which is mentioned in Madhav Nidana, Bhav Prakasha, Sarangdara Samhita, as well as the Maitreya Madhika. Yesterday when I was listening to the Dr. Girish Tillu, he has given the milestone of immunology. I think 1578, the first milestone in the immunology was achieved, or the some research was there, and then it was going on. Still, it's going on up to 19th century, 20th century. Yes. But he himself has mentioned there that is Sarangdam Samhita, it is 1000 BC. 5000 to 1000 BC, the Sarangdar Samhita, it was there. Charak Samhita was there. Yes. Means all the Ayurvedic medicinal preparations along with their different surgical techniques has been mentioned. These are the preparations. These are the treatises, the books, Charak Samhita, Shushrut Samhita, as well as Ashtanga Hridaya. Now, if you see the purpose of Ayurveda, all the pharma faculties we know in the pharmacognosis subject, we have seen the different systems of medicines and what is the principle behind the same. The allopathy was there, Siddha, Yunani, Homeopathy, Ayurveda. Yes, in case of Ayurveda, the main purpose, it is to promote health rather than fight a disease. To promote health rather than fight a disease. We know that it is based on those Panch Mahabhuta, that is Aap, Teja, Vayu, Prithvi, Akash, like that. And Panch Mahabhuta, when in a combination with the three pillars, that is three doshas, Vata, Pitta, Kapha. Means as per the Ayurveda, this Panch Mahabhuta is consist of a macrosome and microsome. Microsome is nothing but a living organism, so the living human being. And the macrosome, that is nothing but a universe. Now, when combined with these three dosha, whenever there is an imbalance between three dosha, it will lead to a disease. So Ayurveda says, you have to establish the balance between three dosha and the you will be the healthy. Now, based upon the use of therapeutic herbs, generally the medicinal plants, those are used either singly or in combination, which is known as a polyherbal. Now, the Sarangdara Samhita, they have mainly focused on a polyherbalism. Now, why to go for the polyherbal formulations? Is it really necessary? Indian traditional systems of medicine, specifically Ayurveda and Siddha, based on a whole plants or a different parts of the plants, either singly or in a combination. Yes, the whole plant or different plants of part, different parts of plant, that is either singly or in a combination. The reason is biological action of an active phytochemical increases when potentiated by that of other plants. One of the other reason is we know most of the bioactives or phytoceuticals which are present in a plant, those are in a very minute amount. Those are not sufficient to achieve that therapeutic efficacy. So when you will be using the different herbs or the different parts in a combination, then it will give you the synergistic effect. At the same moment, the potency of the formulation increases with the reduction of unwanted effects. And it makes the formulation more palatable. Along with that, the patient compliance is also needed, which will be achieved through polyherbal formulation. It brings better patient compliance and therapeutic effect by eliminating the need of taking more than one different single herbal formulation at a time. But at the same moment, one has to keep in mind, while making a polyherbal formulation, you need to see the different properties of those herbs. Those should not be contrast one, means viruddha properties. In Sanskrit, it is known as viruddha property. It means what? For example, if you see, while using the ghee with the honey, the ghee cannot be used in the same proportion as of honey because of its temperature and taste. Some laxative you cannot take along with the astringent drugs. It will give you the antagonistic effect. In the same way, you have to choose or you have to select herbs in that way. So require its correct and rational use, and preventive and corrective steps are equally needed. Now, while talking about the Ayurvedic preparation, so the Ayurveda, in India specifically, cow has a special place. Cow has a significance. In fact, we called cow as a Kamadhenu or Gaumata. Kamadhenu, in the sense, it will fulfill all your wishes or the desires, whatever you wish for. In Ayurveda, specifically Desi cow or the Indian cow has given the special significance or the special place. In fact, if you see the Indian tradition, it is the oldest Indian tradition and it is generally linked to our social rituals. Though social rituals or some of the traditional rituals, but with some scientific base or scientific rationale, it is always there. When we are talking about the Indian cow, that is a specifically species is a Bos indicus. Here the word I have mentioned, that is gavyas, cow products. So the cow derived product, those are nothing but the gavyas. The direct cow derived products, those are the cow dung, cow urine, and the cow milk is there. Whereas the indirect one, that is cow ghee and the curd. So collectively, it is called as a panchagavya. If you see the traditional claims of those individual gavyas, you can see the milk which is used in psychomimetic disorders as constipation, anemia, piles, diarrhea, ulcer, gastrointestinal diseases. In the same way, that is urine, ghee, curd, dung. You can see in this table, each gavya is used in a different disease conditions. And it has been already mentioned in the Ayurveda. The combination of these five cow products is known as a panchagavya. And the treatment which involves the use of panchagavya or the any of the cow products is nothing but a cow pathy. Now the important thing is, it is not necessary that panchagavya obtained from cow should be used either singly or in combination. You can use as a single drug, a single product, or in a combination. In the production of various medicines, manures, pesticides, in a dhuku preparation, tooth powder, bath soap, all these formulations or those are derived from those panchagavyas or the gavyas. Specifically, if we talk about the panchagavya, it is highly beneficial in the treatment of certain diseases like asthma, cardiovascular diseases, renal disorders, rheumatoid arthritis, wound treatment, epileptic seizures, gastrointestinal disorders, tuberculosis, skin infection, even in case of a treatment of cancer and AIDS also, it has been already proven. Some research evidences are already there. Now, out of these all cow products, I will be focusing on the cow ghee. Now, why cow ghee? As mentioned, generally, it is one of the oldest lipid-based delivery system. It is a fat-based delivery system. Cow ghee is considered as an ideal base for the preparation of Ayurvedic formulations to target the specific body tissues. And why it is generally supposed to be ideal base? Because of its typical properties. If you see, it has a unique ability to reach within the deepest tissues of organs, increases potency of certain herbs by carrying the lipid soluble active constituents and nutrients across the cell membrane. Now, how this can be possible? If you see cow ghee, it has a yoga vahitva property. Yoga vahitva means what? Whatever it will be mixed with, it will carry the content or it will carry the same to the target site. Yoga vahitva property. That's why it increases the potency of a certain herbs by carrying the lipid soluble active constituents and nutrients across the cell membrane. It is used as a nourishing, extracting, and absorbing agent. It doesn't spoil easily, preserves original freshness and a potency of herbs as well as foods. It can be stored at a room temperature. Its effectiveness, healing properties never changed, even though it becomes aged. But this statement, it has also one limit. Means it is not necessary, it should be kept, it is not required that it will be kept for 5 to 10 years and then you can use. No, because of being a fatty substance, obviously it will be facing a rancidity and all the problems. So you have to take care of that. Use of 5 to 10 years old cow ghee is highly recommended, but provided if it is stored with a proper storage condition by checking its all parameters. Now, what are the quality parameters of a cow ghee? That is aroma or flavor you need to see. Means the organoleptic characters you need to see. See, in case of any ghrita preparation or cow ghee, the palatability of that product, it depends on the organoleptic or the sensory characters. So sensory characters, that formulation or that ghee or ghrita, it has to comply those sensory parameters first, and then physicochemical evaluation you can go for, which will give you the idea how the stability of that formulation will be and how it is going to, or how it will last long for a particular period for the shelf life. So the ghrita, it is nothing but a Ayurvedic dosage form. In other words, ghrita, it is a medicated ghee. But I would like to specially mention here, in Ayurveda, only the go ghrita, means only the Indian cow ghee based ghrita, is considered as a medicated ghee, not based on the buffalo or the those goat and all the things. Only the Indian cow, specifically Bos indicus. When ghee is processed with some herbal decoction, fresh paste of herbs, means how exactly those ghrita preparations or the ghrita formulations are prepared, in that cow ghee is processed with either crude drugs, the herbal decoctions or the extract, or a fresh paste of the herbs, which is also known as the kalka preparations. As per the formula, now the procedure which you have to adopt for the ghrita preparation, it should be as per the Ayurvedic text or the Ayurvedic formulary of India, means so-called Ayurvedic pharmacopoeia and all the things. No doubt you can prepare your own ghrita preparation, but by following the norms or the guidelines given by that Ayurvedic formulary. In fact, we have prepared our own ghrita and checked for its therapeutic efficacy as well as a physicochemical analysis. Generally, shelf life of Grita for oral intake is a 16 months. It is said to be. Now, while Grita preparation, while preparation of a Grita, Grita Paka Kalpana, this is a process which plays an important role. It's a use for internal or external treatment. Grita prepared by Grita Paka Kalpana, it can be taken easily. It can be taken internally, which will cross blood-brain barrier. It will help to cross the blood-brain barrier, and it strengthens as well as stimulate central nervous system. Just a minute. I'm so sorry. Yeah. The Grita preparation, which is prepared by using Grita Kalpana process, it can be used for internal administration as well as a topical administration. For internal administration, it will easily cross a blood-brain barrier and strengthens as well as stimulate the central nervous system. And when applied topically in the form of a cream or the, as such the Grita preparation, it will diffuse into the soft tissues and produce desired therapeutic action. Now, different types of Grita, that is Navin Grita or a Purana Grita. If you see, Navin Grita means that is a freshly prepared Grita, and Puran Grita, it is a more than 1 year old, that is a Puran Grita. Now, as per the samskaras or the process. The Gritas which were processed with the Murchana Samskara as well as the Shatadhuta Samskara, which are called as a Murchit Grita or Shatadhuta Grita. I will be discussing about these processes in my next slides. What exactly in our research work, how we prepared the Grita formulation and how we optimize it with the Murchana process as well as the Shatadhuta process. This is a these are the insights of integrative medicines along with the natural products, products of traditional systems, polyherbals, as well as by using moderns as well as a novel technique. Now, what exactly we did in last 3 years? Most of the research work which is published in the Journal of Ayurveda and Integrative Medicines as well as a Journal of Complementary and Integrative Medicines. You can see the Ashwagandha Grita we have prepared, and we have studied with reference to Murchana process and storage conditions. Right now, I will be discussing about Shatadhuta and Murchana process. But at the same moments, specifically in this research, we try to assess the storage efficacy of a storage containers along with the storage conditions. We try to assess or try to check the stability of the Grita formulations at accelerated conditions as well as the real-time conditions. In case of accelerated stability conditions at a 45 degrees Celsius temperature and 40 degrees Celsius temperature and 75 relative humidity, for 3 months and 6 months. And for real-time stability study, room temperature as well as 40 degrees Celsius. Along with that, if you know, right now in the market, most of the Grita, those are available in plastic containers or the glass containers. But in earlier days, in ancient days, it was generally kept in a earthen pot. So what will be the impact of those storage containers? We tried to assess the same also. And surprisingly, what we found, the formulations or the Grita preparation, which was kept in a earthen containers, they are most prone for the oxidative condition and all the things. So in our findings, glass containers were found to be most appropriate one. Right now, that study is communicated for the other journal. It's under review. So I have not disclosed that data here. This is the research work which I'm going to discuss today. That is a Balatakadi Grita. This is the Grita which we have prepared. The name, it is a new name which we have given based on the one of the premier ingredient of that Grita. And that Grita was optimized, or it was assessed, it was explored with its Murchana Samskara as well as the Shatadutta process. This is other preparation, that is a Kamdev Grita. We tried to establish the efficacy or the aphrodisiac potential of this formulation in a rat model. This study was in collaboration with the Regional Ayurveda Research Center Gwalior. Dr. Manish Vanzari was there. In collaboration with him, we have completed this study. Even whatever the Grita we have prepared, also we assess the same for its wound healing potential by using in vivo excision and incision wound models. Okay, now come to the Balatakadi Grita. That is the formulation which my PhD student has developed. And how exactly we started with the study, how we optimized it, and check the therapeutic efficacy. This was the outline of this his research work, that is a procurement, authentication, and processing of plant material and standardization of plant material. The earlier speaker, Shyam Prasad Babu, he has explained thoroughly why the authentication as well as the standardization of a plant material is important in case of herbal research. As we know, that is in India only, most of the drugs, those are known with different names in different parts of India. I will just give you the one example, that is a Pashana Bheda. You must have heard about that drug. Pashana Bheda, the name itself says, Pashana Bheda means it is used in a treatment of a kidney stone. Now, for your information, or you will be surprised to know, total 7 drugs are there which are used in the name of a Pashana Bheda, out of which one is the Bergenia ligulata, which is found in those Himalaya or other countries, other parts of India. I'm not aware about the exact the locations, but 7 different plants with the same name. As we know, the vernacular names, how those are varying from place to place. Even in Maharashtra, this Western Maharashtra and all the things, we know that is Kadipatta. Kadipatta, we know that's. But in Vidarbha, the Kadipatta is known as a Godlim. Means if you go there and if you ask for the Kadipatta, then they will get confused. Yes, I mean, this is my own experience. So the names or the proper authentication, it is equally important. So we did the same thing. And then the polyherbal Grita formulation was prepared. Now, specifically for this ghee, it was procured from, that is a Govigyan Anusandhan Research Center, Devdapar, Nagpur. And with the help of that cow ghee, we prepared the polyherbal Grita formulation. And it was further optimized using that is a Murchana process as well as the Shatadutta process. So in that way, we prepared 3 different formulations. That is a plain Balatakadi Grita formulation, Balatakadi Grita formulation processed with the Murchana Samskara, and Balatakadi Grita processed with the Shatadhota process. And then all these three formulations were compared with cow ghee. So total four formulations we subjected for its physicochemical evaluation, organoleptic evaluation, physicochemical evaluation, phytochemical profiling, as well as a chromatography fingerprinting, quantitative estimation of phenolics as well as flavonoids, in vitro biological evaluation, as well as its stability studies, accelerated stability studies, as well as real-time stability studies, along with those stability studies in a different storage containers. And finally, those all formulations, those were subjected for the pharmacological evaluation by using excision wound animal model and incision wound animal model. As I mentioned, this for the Balataka di Grita, from the Western Maharashtra, the plants, the Western Ghat, these plants are specifically renowned over the, these plants are used by the tribal healers for the wound healing. So we selected these four plants, that is a Balataka. Now this is the Balataka di Grita. The name of that Grita is given based on the name of this plant, that is Semicarpus anacardium. Cocculus hirsutus, Argemone mexicana, and Woodfordia fructicosa. These are the herbarium voucher specimen numbers. Those plant materials were authenticated from a BSI, Botanical Service of India, Pune. After collection of that plant material, in Ayurveda, one of the important processes there, that is a Shodhana Samskara. Shodhana Samskara, or also you can say it is a detoxification. So all the plant material, those were subjected for a detoxification or Shodhana Samskara, that is a Semicarpus anacardium, fruits as well as leaves. Now, how exactly the Shodhana Samskara for Semicarpus anacardium was carried out in case of a fruits, because Semicarpus anacardium is supposed to be toxic one. So the thalamus portion of the collected fruits were removed and kept in a gomutra for 7 days. Gomutra is nothing but a cow urine, and then washed with water. The fruits were then shifted to a jute bag containing brick gravels for 3 days and rubbed thoroughly and dried. To achieve or to remove the toxic compounds like bilvenol as well as anacardic acid, Semicarpus anacardium leaves, those were washed and washed with the distilled water so that it will get free from dust, foreign particles, as well as the debris. Argemone mexicana, Cocculus hirsutus, and Woodfordia leaves. If you see the whole plant of these two plants and whole plant of Argemone mexicana and Cocculus sativus, Cocculus hirsutus, those were washed with distilled water as well as lime water to get it free from those dust and earthy matter. Whereas in case of a Woodfordia leaves and flowers, those were simply washed with the water to get it free from those debris and particles. Now the drying conditions, those fruits, different methods or the method which we used for the drying of the collected plant material, specifically in case of a Semicarpus anacardium, fruits were dried in sunlight for 10 to 12 days, whereas the leaves were dried under shade for 6 to 7 days at room temperature. Whereas in case of Argemone mexicana, shade drying was followed by own drying below 50 degrees Celsius. Cocculus hirsutus, that is a shade drying for 6 to 7 days, and Woodfordia fructosa also follow the same. These are the plant materials. The morphological characterization was done. This is a microscopic characterization. And then it was subjected for a proximate analysis. As Shyam Prasad Babu has mentioned, that plant material need to be standardized based on certain parameters. And in the same way, by following the, that is a Ayurvedic pharmacopoeia as well as herbal pharmacopoeia, the standard parameters which are necessary to comply that medicinal plants, we evaluated different parameters, that is moisture content, total ash, acid insoluble ash, water soluble ash, ethanol soluble extractives, methanol soluble extractives, extractive values, as well as the FOM, that is foreign organic matters. even those plant material, those were subjected for a phytochemical analysis to confirm the presence of active secondary metabolites, because the secondary metabolites are supposed to be responsible for that, it's a therapeutic efficacy. So we did the same. Now come to the formulation part. How exactly that Grita formulation was prepared? Those authenticated plant materials, that is Semicarpus anacardium, Arginine mexicana, Cocculus hirsutus, and Wood Podia fructicosa, those were extracted with alcohol and mixed in equal proportion. Now see, most of the, why we are calling it as a novel one, or because this composition, it is not mentioned in any Ayurvedic pharmacopoeia and herbal pharmacopoeia. We have selected this plant material based on the used by tribal people for specifically wound healing. Our aim was to develop a formulation for a wound healing. So we selected this one. Now, if you see most of the Grita preparation in pharmacopoeia, they are using the crude drugs of the, no doubt, decoction they have mentioned, but most of them, they are used with a, that is a crude drug or raw material. Here we tried to make the extracts. We have selected the extract based on their screening as well as a, which are enriched with the secondary metabolites. So first we prepared the kalka, fine paste. If you see the particular ratio, that is 1:16:4, kalka, water, and cow ghee, means fine paste, kalka, drava dravya, and sneha dravya. Sneha dravya, that is nothing but a fat material, that is cow ghee and water. So what we did, initially, some amount of ghee, means out of two parts of ghee, it was taken, it was poured in a vessel. It was kept on a moderate flame so that it will get melt. And then the fine paste, water, and the remaining amount of cow ghee, it was mixed in the same vessel so that it will pass through a Grita Paka Kalpana process. It was mixed together and treated on a low to moderate fire in a vessel. Now this process will continue till the complete evaporation of a water. Now how will you confirm that is there is complete evaporation of water? So again, the in Ayurveda, that is Sneha Siddhi Lakshana. That is that specific term is there. Means you have to check it for a Sneha Siddhi Lakshana. Some paste of or some part of that you have to take and you have to burn in a fire. It should give you the crackling sound. Then you can confirm, yes, Grita formulation is ready. And then it was filtered through a muslin cloth. And whatever the formulation, Grita formulation, we got, we named it as a Balatikadi Grita formulation. Here, it is abbreviated as a PHBG formulation. You can see the composition here. That is a Balataka, Semicarpus anacardium, Arginine mexicana, Cocculus hirsutus, and Wood Podia. Those were taken in equal proportion. Cow ghee, 1 liter, and 4 ghee. This is the water, 4 liter. Means that is one, this one is a 1:4:16 ratio. This is the formulation which we prepared. Then it was subjected for the organoleptic as well as sensory characters. The color, it was compared with the cow ghee initially. Means the cow ghee, it was a golden yellow color, whereas the formulation which we got, that is golden greenish back color. Now greenish color, it was because of the those herbs which we used. Odor, it was a pleasant and characteristic, whereas it was a pleasant. Now see, here this odor taste, it was specifically noted when the Grita preparation was freshly prepared. Even the taste was, which was checked when it is a melted condition only. It is in liquefied condition only. So it will give you the exact results, or you can confirm the same one. So we follow the same procedure in case of all the formulations. The appearance, that is, it was a granular. In both cases, formulations, it was found to be granular one. Whereas the touch sensation, it was smooth and soft in case of cow ghee, whereas in case of polyherbal palatakadigrita, it was an oily one. We also checked, subjected it for a physicochemical evaluation, and we found the pH, viscosity, moisture content, specific gravity, refractive index, acid values, saponification. These are the all parameters which are generally checked for the fats and oils. We use the same parameters. Even in Ayurvedic pharmacopoeia also, these parameters has been given for the standardization of the Grita preparations. The same formulation, it was subjected for a chromatography, HPLC chromatography, by using the markers, that is the gallic acid and quercetin. The available markers which we found, we use the same one for the quantification. Then being fatty in nature, the oily product, it was subjected for a GCMS analysis in a plain ghee. Total 17 peaks were, 17 compounds were there, out of which 11 were saturated, 6 were so unsaturated, where it was increased here up to the 32. Further, it was subjected for a quantitative estimation of polyphenols as well as the flavonoids. In case of a polyphenol content, that is a pollen culture assay method was used. In flavonoid content, aluminum chloride assay method was used. Those formulations, cow ghee and PHBG, that is a Bharatakadigrita formulation, it was subjected for a in vitro antioxidant analysis. And you can see here, as compared to cow ghee, I am not saying those are the better than the standard one, but as compared to cow ghee, those formulations have a better results. Now, in case of a physicochemical analysis, physicochemical properties of a prepared formulation during accelerated stability study. As I mentioned, this accelerated stability study at 40 degrees Celsius, 40 plus minus 5 degree temperature, and 75 relative humidity. And it was checked for initially, then after 1 month, 3 months, and 6 months. So these are the observations, how by the time the pH is reduced, how the acid value, those are increasing. Acid value, it is nothing but a it is a index of a free fatty acids which is present. So by the time it will increase, so definitely the more amount of a free fatty acids, it will lead to a rancidity. So after particular that period, or the ghee or a ghrita preparation which is kept for a longer duration, if it is not maintained with the proper condition, then it is a lead to, or it is prone for the rancification. Acid value, saponification value, iodine value, peroxide value, Richard Michel and Polinsky value. Based on the data which we got for 3 months and 6 months, we try to estimate the shelf life of a formulation. So one formula is there. By using that, we use the aging factor 5 for the climatic zone 1 and 2. And aging factor 3.3 for climatic zone 3 and 4. So in case of a PHBG for climatic zone 1 and 2, the estimated shelf life is a 2.4 years. Whereas in case of a climatic zone 3 and 4, it is a 1.6 years. It is of a polyherbal Bharatakadigrita. It is not just, I will remind you, it was not processed with any other process like Murchana, or the Shatadutta. It is just a plain polyherbal Bharatakadigrita preparations. Now, these are the stability studies under real-time stability at room temperature. So based on the data, the shelf life for the real-time conditions, that is 3.4 years for climatic zone 1 and 2, and 3 and 4 for 2.2. Now, whatever the formulations we prepared, our intention was to check it. It's a therapeutic efficacy in wound management. So we try to assess the wound healing activity. If you know the specifically wound, it is divided into four phases. The first phase, that is with the blood clotting as well as the hemostasis, will be their second phase, initiated by the inflammation. Third, that is a proliferation, and the final one, that is a tissue remodeling, or the re-epithelization, so, with the forming a scar and all the things. So, but the problem is the goals of wound treatment have not been changed even after 5,000 years. Patients still deserve a fast and antiseptic closure of a wound without imposing any scar. That wound burden need to be reduced. A new therapeutic approach for acute and long-term wound management is required, and that's why, at the same moment, to understand the better physiology of healing, we try to assess our prepared formulation for its wound healing ability. So wound healing ability, it was carried out with the help of excision wound model as well as incision wound model. The albinorides were selected with the proper permission of animal ethical committee and following the guidelines of a CPCSA. This is the animal ethical approval number is there. Initially, we tried to check the acute dermal toxicity studies as per the OECD 402 guidelines. And we prepared three different groups. That is, one is the control, other is a reference standard. That is a povidone iodine. We use the marketed preparation, that is cipladine, and the taste preparation, that is our prepared Gritha formulation. So the groups, the group 1, 2, 3, group 1 was of control, which was receiving only the cow ghee. Group 2, reference standard of povidone iodine, whereas group 3, polyherbal baladakadi Gritha. Now, if you see in all the groups, there is the application of that preparation or the cow ghee or the standard once a day on a wounded surface area. Now, how long the study was continued? Till the complete recovery of that wound. So, and the parameters of that wound healing activity, it was assessed in terms of wound contraction as well as the closure rate, epithelization time, percent wound contraction, and the hydroxyproline content. Now, why hydroxyproline content it was measured? Because it is nothing but an index of the collagen content. Means the collagen, the measurement of collagen or the collagen index, it will give you the strength of that wound strength. So it is one of the parameters which we selected for our study. You can see here, the area of wound contraction and re-epithelization time on a post-excision days of a cow ghee, control group, reference standard, as well as the test. In case of a plain ghee, the complete post-wound or complete closure, it was on 21st day, whereas in case of reference standard, it was 18, whereas in case of our formulation, it was a 15. Re-epithelization time, it was almost 15 days in case of our prepared formulations. From this image, you can see this is a control treated group, standard group, and test group. As I mentioned, on 15 days, on 15th day, the wound was completely closed by using our formulation, whereas in the ghee on 15 day, it was still there. Percent excision wound contraction, that is a percentage area of wound contraction on post excision day was checked. And you can see here, that is a PHBG formulation. Almost here 15 day, it is almost 100% as compared to the 21st day of a ghee. Hydroxyproline content, which is the measurement of a collagen indices, that is a 4.23 in case of a PHBG formulation. Incision wound healing activity, the groups were the same. Only the parameters were the wound breaking strength as well as some histopathological studies we did. in case of a wound breaking strength, the formulation or the group treated with a polyherbal balatakadi grita wound breaking strength found to be highest one, that is a 531.50 as compared with the reference standard as well as a control group. If you see the histopathological examination, this is specifically normal skin, which is showing epidermis. This is the epidermis part. This is the dermis as well as the sebaceous gland. Whereas this is the control group treated with the cow ghee showing necrosis and fibrosis in dermis section. Neovascularization and ulceration. Neovascularization as well as ulceration. And reference standard group, this treated with the povidone iodine treatment showing necrosis and fibrosis in dermis neovascularization. Whereas the BG formulation treated group showing necrosis and fibrosis in dermis neovascularization and ulceration. Now, as I mentioned, as I told you earlier, that is our aim was not to just prepare the Grita formulation, but also to check the scientific rationale or to give the research evidence for the Ayurvedic processes like Murchana as well as Shatadhuta, which are highlighted or emphasized by Ayurveda. If you try to refer that Ayurvedic pharmacopoeia, you can see if Ashwagandha formulation, Ashwagandha Grita is there, on the next page you will see Ashwagandha Murchita Grita is also there. Right now, very few research has been done in that direction with reference to this Ayurveda processes. I don't know whether you are aware about specifically pharma faculties. The Ayush, they are asking for the research proposals in the area of Ayurveda biology. Now, Ayurveda biology, even when I came across that Ayurveda biology research scheme, I thought I will apply for or I will propose any Ayurvedic preparation and I will apply the project. But they have specifically mentioned you cannot go in that way or the such projects will be not entertained. Then what exactly they are expecting? They are expecting the validation of Ayurvedic processes like Murchana, Shatadhuta, even Shambhavu Prasad sir or Girish Tillu sir has mentioned about Anupana. Anupana means how the herb, with what you are taking that medicinal plants. Yes, even the water can be considered as one of the material substance for Anupana process and you can propose the same one. So here, this polyherbal Bhalatakadi Grita, it was optimized. It was processed with the Murchana Sanskara as well as the Shatadhuta. Now, what exactly we did? See, this is the after processing. This is the Bhalatakadi Murchita Grita and this is the Bhalatakadi Shatadhuta Grita. So in that case, this is a Murchita, Murchana process. So the first step, that is the same one. In fact, in complete procedure, if you recall in my earlier slides, I have mentioned how that polyherbal Bhalatakadi Grita formulations were prepared by using kalka, water and ghee. Means that the fine paste, dravdravya as well as snehadravya in the ratio of 1:16:4. Yes. Now, instead of a plain cow ghee, you have to use the murchita ghee. Rest of the process will be the same. In short, in case of a Murchana process of that Grita formulation, instead of a plain cow ghee, you have to use a murchita ghee. In the same way, in case of a Shatadhuta, you have to use that cow ghee, which is prepared by, which is processed with a Shatadhuta Samskara. Shatadhuta, Shata means 100, Dhauta means washing, means that ghee which is washed by 100 times, which is washed with water by 100 times. You have to use that ghee in the preparation of the Grita formulation. And we followed the same. So you can see here, the components are the same, only the murchit ghee we have used in place of cow ghee. Rest of the process are same. And here, that is the samskar of shatadhata samskar of cow ghee. Here, instead of a plain cow ghee, we use here along with kalka and water. Instead of murchita ghee, we use this grita and we prepare the polyherbal balatakadi shatadhata grita. Now, the question is, murchana samskara means exactly what? Why it is called as a murchana or murchit ghee? How it can be prepared? In case of a preparation of a murchit ghee, there is a use of a murchana herbs. Now I will say, if you see the list of those murchana herbs, those are specifically antioxidant herbs. Now which herbs are used? That is a Terminalia chebula, Emblica officinalis, Terminalia bellerica, and Cypress rotundus, and Curcuma longa, and Citrus medica. Here you have to use the fruits of Terminalia in case of rhizomes of Cypress rotundus, as well as a Haridra, that is Curcuma longa, and the juice of a Citrus medica. Those are in equal proportion. Those are used for the preparation of a murchit ghee. How easily it is prepared? The smooth paste of, or the kalka of these herbs, murchana herbs, is prepared. In a large vessel, you have to heat that ghee at a moderate flame, on a moderate flame, so that it will get melt. And then you had to add this kalka as well as water. Boil down a slow fire till complete evaporation of water, and then you have to strain through the muslin cloth. So you will be getting a murchit ghee. Now, instead of a plain cow ghee, you have to use this murchit ghee for the preparation of your grita preparation processed with a murchana. And so we did the same thing. We use the murchit ghee instead of a plain cow ghee. Now, what is the significance of this murchana samskara? It removes bad odor and rancidity. In other words, it will free your grita formulation from durgandhi or amadosha. It also maintains a ratio of unsaturated and saturated fats, which are supposed to be suitable for human physiology. Increases stability of a grita formulation. It imparts desirable color and taste and aroma. It ensures maximum acceptability in terms of palatability. It modifies solubility pattern and absorbability. At the same moment, it enhances therapeutic effectiveness of a drug. Now the next samskara, that is a shata dhota. As I mentioned, shata for 100, dhota means washing, 100 times washing. How exactly it is done? Cow ghee mixed with a distilled water, or it is simply mixed with distilled water, and it is triturated for 5 to 8 minutes in a clean copper vessel with the help of a laboratory agitator. After 5 to 8 minutes trituration, the content of vessels, it was allowed to settle and water was decanted carefully to avoid loss of ghee. Means, after trituration with the water, you have to decant it. You have to remove that one. But you need to take care that there should not be a loss of a ghee. Again, the fresh slot of distilled water is added to previously washed ghee. And the procedure is repeated for 100 times. So the ghee which is washed with 100 times is nothing but a shata dhota ghee. That you have to use in a preparation of a balatakadi grita. Now, what is the significance of the same? The initial trituration of a ghee, that is, ghee is nothing but an oil phase. When it is triturated with a aqueous phase water, it forms a W by O emulsion, lipid phase, which is the cow ghee is supposed to be a major phase. So it is a W by O emulsion. Now the further washings, means you have to wash it for 100 times. So further washings, which is generally associated with the pressure, because you are using along with the laboratory agitators. So it reduces the particle size of a fat granules, and successive washings, it will lead to a phase inversion. So it will turn from W by O emulsion to O by W emulsions. Then further washings, it leads to the formation of a complex system, that is a W by O by W emulsions. Why the phase inversion was there? Because ultimately, after successive washing, the ratio of water will be the more. So the phase inversion will be there. And then finally, it will give the complex W by O by W emulsion. Now, what exactly happens in this Shatadhota process? There is a splitting of a fat. That is, fat is hydrolyzed in the presence of water to yield free fatty acids and glycerol, which are removed with aqueous phase. Change in pH from acidic to neutral, which makes it beneficial to prevent a skin irritation. It gives a characteristic granular oily consistency and odor present of cow ghee. That cow ghee odor, it is decreases, resulting in a homogeneous, smooth, non-oily product, which is easier to apply and increases the rate of absorption through skin. Decreases degree of unsaturation, which eventually reduces the chances of rancidity. Increases stability of grita and makes product elegant and suitable for a topical application. Even the more amount of water, it will be more with a percent of water. So it is more suitable for topical applications. So in this way, we prepared these three different formulations. Plain polyherbal balatakadi grita. This is a PHBG2, which is prepared by processing with the murchana ghee, and this is prepared by processing with the shatadhota ghee. These are the organoleptic parameters. Physicochemical evaluation, you can see how the pH has been increased from acidic to neutral. Moisture content, specific gravity, refractive index, acid value. Acid value, because of the antioxidant herbs, the acid value, free fatty acids, it was reduced from PHBG to PHBG2, means plain polyherbal balatakadi grita to balatakadi grita processed with the murjana sanskara. The same thing in case of saponification value, iodine value, peroxide value. GCMS analysis was done to analyze the changes in the grita formulation in terms of fatty acids, and we found remarkable changes. Even if you want to know the detail, which are the content and all the things, already I shared you the screenshot of the research paper, which is already published in JIM, and it is an open access journal. You can refer, and for any queries, definitely you can reach to me on the given mail ID. The PHBG, that is 1, 2, 3, plain balatakadi grita processed with murchana and shatadhota. Those were subjected for a quantitative estimation in terms of polyphenols as well as the flavonoids. And these are the results, whereas specifically PHBG2, because of the antioxidant herbs, those herbs which are supposed to be enriched in secondary metabolite. So here our analysis also revealed the same thing. By DPPH method of PHBG2 and PHBG3, it revealed almost the same results. Again, in case of those prepared formulations, we did accelerated stability studies. In case of both formulations, so based on the accelerated stability data, the shelf life, which we estimated by using that specified formula for climatic zone 1 and 2, PHBG2, means the formulation processed with the murchana samskara, shelf life, it was estimated as 2.9 years, whereas in case of shatadhota, it is 3.8 years, means the shatadhota formulation prepared or the processed with the shatadhota it gives almost the maximum or the more duration as compared to the plain polyorbital. Here, this study itself, it reveals or it shows how the Murchana as well as the Shatatata process, it enhances the stability as well as the shelf life of the Grita formulation. This is a real-time stability data. And these are the shelf life estimated as per the real-time stability data, 3.7 years and 3.8 years, whereas for climatic zone 3 and 4, 2.5 years. For both, it is 2.5 years only. Here, it is just a graphical presentation for the data which has been already shown. Now, as compared with the polyherbal Balatakadi Grita, the Grita preparation processed with Murchana and Shatadota, we subjected those Grita preparation for wound healing activity, because already earlier data, it shows how those processes helps in stability of Grita formulation. But in the same way, this data, it shows it also enhances the therapeutic efficacy. In case of a polyherbal Balatakadi Grita, re-epithelization time was 15 days. Whereas in case of a Murchana process Grita, it is 13 days and it's 12.8 days in case of a Shatadota Grita. This is a percentage area of wound contraction as compared to polyherbal Balatakadi Grita. You can see almost on 12th day, only the 99% of wound was contracted. This is in a graphical presentation. Yes, you can see here that is a as compared to the polyherbal Balatakadi Grita, how the wound has been treated. Even on 12th day only, this Grita processed with the Shatadota, it helps in the healing of the wound. Hydroxyproline content, it was found maximum of the highest in case of a Grita processed with the Shatadota. This is the wound breaking strength. Here also you can see the Grita processed with the Shatadota is with the highest readings. So finally, in short, I would like to summarize that is this research work. It was an attempt to develop and evaluate GBS polyherbal Balatakadi formulation with a reference to its Murchana and Shatadota process. As I said, if you see in case of a Shatadota, only you can see 2 to 3 research papers are there. Most of the articles or the review article they have mentioned, but scientific or the research evidence is lacking somewhere. So our aim was to establish the research evidence for those Murchana process as well as the Shatadota process. And at the same moment, we try to develop a novel Balatakadi polyherbal Grita formulation. In Ayurveda, cow ghee is reported to possess wound healing activity. So we have used that cow ghee as a base for the same purpose. Most of the formulations in Ayurveda are prepared based on the polyherbal concept. The 4 different plants which we used based on the report of a local tribal community in Western Ghats of Maharashtra. Therefore, ghee-based polyherbal formulations was found to be supreme alternative for wound management to reduce economic burden, pain discomfort, and scar formation. The pharmacognostic studies as well as the proximity analysis, it confirms or it complies the pharmacopeial standards, which helps in a further exploration or the preparation of a Grita formulations. Homogeneous, smooth, non-granular, and non-oily appearance of a PHBG3. PHBG3 is nothing but a polyherbal Balatakadi Grita processed with the Shatadota, was found to be easier for a topical application, which ultimately improves patient compliance. Shatadota Samskara, it increases shelf life of a Grita formulation by almost 1.5 times for the Indian environment, specifically for climatic zone 3 and 4. For accelerated stabilization, this Grita formulation exhibited exhibited wound healing activity in both excision and incision wound model, which may be because of the flavonoids and phenolic compounds present in the individual plant extracts. The strength of formulation prepared for wound healing study was found to be increased when the ghee was processed with the polyherbs. Therefore, the use of PHVG formulations prepared by standard Ayurvedic protocol for wound management was successfully demonstrated. The same formulation we applied for the Indian patent, it is in 2019. Right now, it's under examination, and hopefully we will be receiving the first examination report very soon. Future studies, in fact, right now, the studies on those polyherbal Balatakadigrita in progress, that is a plausible wound healing activity which is associated with the diabetes, and detailed mechanism of action involved in wound healing. These are some references. Finally, I'm very much thankful to the Mr. Sandesh Vyar, who has prepared this presentation. Actually, it is his own study. Dr. Sandeep Hate, who is a taxonomist for Nagpur, who help us in identification as well as authentication of plant material, as well as Botanical Survey of India. And Dr. Y.S. Bhattambare, sir, from Sumtibai Shah Ayurveda Mahavidyalaya Hadapsar, who under whose guidance those Grita preparations were formulated. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, Dr. Shailendra Gural, sir, for this informative session on polyherbal Grita formulation and integrative approach. So now we'll move on to the question answer session. So the first question is from Dr. Nigunja, sir. The question is, sir, can we incorporate this formulation in modern topical formulation?
Modern topical formulations like what?
Dr. Nikunja, sir, you can unmute yourself and ask your question for better clarifications.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Tell me, ma'am.
Sir, first of all, I would like to congratulate and say that this is a wonderful work that you have done in this Grita formulation.
Thank you, ma'am.
And my question is like, as you told that by this 100 time washing with the water, that Grita is converted into boiling water in oil type of like. So can we incorporate this Grita formulation in ointment or cream base? Which would be more patient convenience, or like we can improve further its activity or like that?
Ma'am, in case of ointment and creams, we will be using any ointment base for the cream base, right?
Yes.
Now here in Grita formulation, cow ghee itself acting as one of the base. So I don't think you need to go for any other preparation. Simply, this Grita you can apply topically in any case.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. For the next question, I asked Lata ma'am to unmute herself and ma'am can ask the question directly.
Very good afternoon, and thank you very much for a very informative session in spite of all the health problems we had. Am I audible?
Yeah, ma'am.
I wanted to know, like, I'm interested in working on dry skin or psoriasis. So, is your Grita formulation will help in this line of treatment for the psoriasis?
Absolutely, ma'am. Absolutely. In fact, very frank to say, right now we are working in the same direction.
Okay.
Means this is also one of the area which we are exploring right now, the cow ghee based formulation. In fact, I can say you in Ayurveda also there are some Grita preparation which has been prescribed specifically for psoriasis. But as we developed such a novel formulation, so you can take the herbs which are useful in a psoriasis treatment, and you can prepare your own ghita preparation and you can explore it. No issue. Not only psoriasis, but for any skin disorders, you can use it. You can check it.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
We will
yeah.
move on to the next question. Is there any regulations for using of animals during testing of Ayurvedic formulations?
No.
Okay,
sir. See, in case of Ayurvedic formulation or any formulation, the first thing you need to check the acute toxicity study, or in case of a topical preparation, acute dermal toxicity study. The OECD guidelines are there. So as per the OECD guidelines, if you are doing that, there will be no issue.
Okay. Thank you, sir. The next question is, where it is available of the standard procedures to perform physiochemical parameters?
Of course, the Ayurvedic pharmacopoeia is there, as well as a herbal pharmacopoeia is there. Well, otherwise, I can share. Just share me your email ID. I will share those guidelines or the handbook for the physicochemical analysis of the same.
Thank you, sir.
You just share your email ID. I will share the same.
Okay, sir. I will ask him to share.
Yeah.
So the next question is from Dr. Shanmugapriya. And the question is, how about the increase in consumption of saturated fats present in ghee that causes obesity? Please comment on this, sir.
Sorry, I didn't get you the question. I didn't get the question.
Okay, sir. I will repeat once more. How about the increase in consumption of saturated fats present in the ghee that causes obesity?
Okay, you mean to say by consuming the ghee, there are the maximum chances that it will lead to the obesity. Am I right?
Yes.
Actually, for your kind information, the consumption of ghee, it will never increase the obesity. In fact, if any Ayurvedic physician is there, in fact, even I was assuming the same one. I was assuming the same thing. That is the consumption of ghee, it will lead to the increase the obesity and all the things. But here, in this case, whatever the herbs which we are using, they are proven with not only their wound healing ability, but also if you see the most of the polyphenol, the flavonoid, they have the anti-obesity activity also. So definitely it will not lead to the same thing.
Okay, thank you, sir. For the next question, I request Dr. Varsha Tiwari for unmute herself and ask the question.
Please start your video also, ma'am.
Varsha Tiwari, ma'am, I can see her question here. What do you think, which one is the best method for Ghita formulation? Yes, ma'am. Actually, total four different methods are there for Ghita formulation. You can opt any one method. As per the your convenience, I don't think it will be a difficult one. In Ayurvedic pharmacopoeia as well as Ayurveda formulary, the four methods has been given. In fact, whatever the method I have explained in my presentation, you can take that one also, no problem at all. In fact, whatever the research manuscript which we have published right now, those are the open access articles, so you can follow them. Otherwise, you just share your email ID. I will share those articles and the procedure also. And one more thing, as I mentioned initially in my talk, I am working in collaboration. So if really someone is interested to work with us, you are always welcome for formulation aspects, so the analytical aspects, as well as even the pharmacological activity aspects. We are always open.
Thank you, sir. So we will move on to the next question. Name of herbs for psoriasis skin disease.
Ma'am, so many herbs are there. Actually, you just check the Google Scholar and then you will get the list of the herbs which you can use. Otherwise, if you share your email ID, I will give you the list. One more thing. I can see here the question by... Okay, the Undale ma'am has asked me That is a just minute. Vaishali Undale, ma'am. Yes, Balataka is reported for the allergic episodes in most of population. Did you observe in such a response? Ma'am, before using the Balataka, we detoxified it. As I mentioned in my earlier slide, that is a Shodhan Samskara. So initially, we prepared it with the Gomutra as well as a cow milk so that it was completely detoxificated, and then we used. Even in case of topical formulation studies, the animal studies, if you have seen, I have mentioned that is acute dermal toxicity as per the OECD 402. So we followed the same guidelines and we didn't find any problem for the any allergic episodes.